Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Today is the concluding session of our Bible study, and we decided to have a single class together today, first to give opportunity of answering some 1, 2, 3 very important questions that may be bothering our hearts from the Bible, just from the Bible studies alone. Please don't ask questions from the main sessions. Questions from the Bible study alone, that we are going to take just about 2, 3 questions. And then after that, I will try to do a summary of the entire Bible study from the pulpit. And at the end, we will take a hymn and pray together. Praise the Lord. Now, who has a question that is from the Bible study and you would like us to handle first?
Thank you for the opportunity. In my group, we discuss concerning the gifts that will not allow the leader to function well. And I asked that question there, but I am not satisfied. I want us to still continue a little or push it a little. Now, when you give gifts to people, either before a favor is offered or after, which one is better? Because there's what we call gratification. If you say, if I have done something and you say, share an answer, thank you, sir. This is your gift. It's still a gift or bribe, saying that what I have done for you this time, I should do more. That is my own feeling. So when a leader collects such gifts, to me it's a way of saying, I want more help from you. I want preferment. I want promotion. And I want a lot of other things. So if you look into it,
praise the Lord. I think I'm understanding the context now. The way you have asked the question, you are not dealing with church member coming to give the pastor gift. Sir. Now, did you see the reverend? What did he call that one? As if we should not look at that one. Praise the Lord. Now, praise the Lord. Now, I hope you understand that the first principle we are dealing with is that gifts, material gifts, they have a capacity to blind the leader. And that does not exempt the pastor-church member relationship. In fact, that is the first one we are dealing with. The other one you are talking about, between maybe the junior pastor and the bishop or the higher priest, all of them is the same. The principles are the same. If the other one is Ajemonu, the other one too can be Ajemonu to them. All right, but we are not looking at it because the Bible didn't look at it like that. actually the point where the man of God can bring the sharpness of ministry and say, God has done something to you now that is serious. Serve him with the rest of your life. Don't just tell them they should go and put it in the offering bag. Because once they put it in the offering bag also, what will they do? They say, ah, yes. Now, if they are going to put money in the offering bag, that's late for them. And we shouldn't quarrel when they do that. But at that moment, if we say, please, God has done something for you now. God is demanding something from you in response. If it is at that time you say, you used to do like this, stop it. Will they stop it or not? Because they will be responding to who? To God. So, on a general note, a servant of God should resist any attempt to pay you after doing a service for God. I hope you are following what I'm saying. Now, but if you have not done ministry or done anything, and a church member stands up from his house and he says, I feel led to give the man of God this, it's not wrong to receive such gifts. I hope you are following what I'm saying. I'm saying generally speaking, because it is even possible that somebody has brought like that, and the Holy Spirit will say, don't take this one. Because there is no way we can know the motive in the hearts of people. So like our reverend was trying to say, sometimes some people will like to domisiwaju so that they can do what? They can march on wet clothes. So he's coming to make a very hard request from the reverend. Something that he knows will not be correct. But in order to blind your eyes, he quickly comes with a gift. And when you have collected the gift, you have eaten it, and then he comes back and he says, you see, I just want to give an example. I don't know what obtains, for example, in our tradition. If, for example, the church has said, don't bury anybody in their compound. I don't know whether there are some churches like that. It upsets in Anglican. They say, don't bury anybody in their compound. But then he wants to bury his grandfather in his compound. And then he begins to pour water in front. He pours water to the parish priest. He goes to pour it to the venerable. He goes right up to the bishop. When he sees that the grandfather is going to quarter to die. So by the time the thing happens now, and he says, it is Chief Lagbaja that is burying his grandfather. Then you start seeing, and something happens. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. I've only given an example. By the grace of God, every man of God should know that your payment comes from where? From God. In fact, the one that the church gives to us officially, as far as I'm concerned, is even a help. The person who is supposed to pay you, and if a man of God is limiting the resources that comes into his family to only what he collects from the church, he is cheating himself. Because it's not the church who sent you. I hope you are following what I'm saying. If you apply to heaven and say, Lord, how much are they giving us? 15,000, 20,000. He can't make ends meet. Father, please send resources. Does God not answer such question? Prayer? Praise the Lord. I have several experiences in this as a pastor. When I got to the point and I even believed God to meet my needs, and I stopped, I told the church that there was no need for them to pay me. I'm not saying it's wrong to collect money from the church. Have I said that? All right. But I got to that point and I decided. And then suddenly my grandmother died. And we went home for family meeting, and my father sat down and said, and he turned to me as the firstborn of the family and said, "To Pastor, are you going to help me to bury my mother?" That was a very strategic question, isn't it? So I said, no, why not? It's your mother, but it's my own grandmother also. Whatever God helps me, I will do. I was opening my mouth. So when they started apportioning the thing, I quickly say, Lord, what should I do? And I felt that I don't want to pour my money in all that they will eat and go and throw away. I said, okay, I will take a video coverage. I will pay for this. I'll pay for that. I was speaking it thinking that how much by the time you gather everything, the money is not much. Only for me to see the bill. Then I began to scratch my head. But then I had learned that. I said, God, can you not bury my grandmother for me? And you know that those are the things that make reverence sometimes dip their hand where they ought not to take it. You use things that are not supposed to be used. So I closed my eyes. I said, Father, please. And you will know, if I shared the testimonies, somebody just came to my house. I didn't tell, in fact, I didn't tell the church. I told myself, if I announce in the church, many people will come. Then I will be obliged to feed them. Since I didn't give anybody notice, anybody that hears and they come, it's all right. They will eat. But then somebody came and said, Pastor, I wanted to give you Christmas gift. This is in April. But I don't know how it happened. I forgot. And the thing is just troubling me. I feel, I don't even know, and I don't know which kind of gift I will give you now since it's no longer Christmas. And he brought a check. And that settled something. I was in my house the following day. Somebody who is not even a member of my church at all. He was just passing on the road. And I happened to come out of my compound that time. I wanted to do my morning walk to go and pray. I said, Pastor. It's a long time. It's a long time. I don't know what is a long time, what is not a long time. But he put his hand in his pocket and a bundle of money came out again. I collected it. I went back into the room first to drop that one. Praise the Lord. Now, the reason why I'm doing this is that many, many times, what turns us as pastors into beggars is because we are looking to men. Once your eyes stop looking to Jesus and you start looking at people's pockets and start looking at people's salaries. Sometimes we want to do launching for a project in the church. That's the reason why we normally put it at the end of the month. Ntori kini sa. Maye se gbowo osu. Now, so if it is people's salaries that you are depending on, how much will we get? My experience with God is that what I as a human being cannot tell people to give, their creator can tell them to give it. Am I correct? We wanted to roof our building and we were praying. I pray. And there was this, you didn't know what went on. We have the roof, it's not covered and it's raining season. And we are going to have service on Sunday. Every time we are praying and the clouds come out, you have to summarize quickly or else it's rain that will share the grace for you. Saturday, and I was looking, rain beat us preparing for the service the following day. Rain beat us. I said, God, if rain beat us on Saturday, will rain beat us again on, we came on Thursday. It was a midweek service. This way this rain is raining every day. Sunday. Lord, won't you do something? Then somebody stood up from inside the church. He came to me and said, excuse me, sir, can I see you? The way he was shaking, I knew something was happening. So I said, what is the trouble? He said, as I sat down there, God said that me, I'm gathering money to go and do, he wanted to do ICANN exam. That he wanted to go and do ICANN exam and he's been saving money to go and register for the exam. That God said, you are gathering money for ICANN and there is no roof on top of my own head. So God said, you should go and empty all that money and bring it. I said, if it is exam, go and do the exam. Because if you qualify, you become a scattered accountant. Your salary will increase. Your tithe will also increase. So don't worry. God will benefit. He said, no, excuse me, sir. That's not the issue. It's because I'm just telling you, and God said, I should bring it for roof. And that roof must be there before Sunday. When I pray, God said, don't tamper, don't touch it. I'm the one. I hope you are following what I'm saying. I have learned that a prayerful pastor doesn't need to have plenty of money in his pocket. Whenever he needs it, if he prays, God will do what? God will answer. And God is not a respecter of persons. If we live right, and we are in good relationship with God, we are hearing his voice, he's talking to us, our needs will be met. You know what the Bible says? Woe unto the man who puts his trust in man. That includes in church members. Isn't it? Praise the Lord. I think we have answered that question a little bit. Kai, all right. Is a follow-up on this question or another one? Yes, sir.
About 8 years ago, somebody is dead now. Came to me, one of our members wanted to give some contract. And eventually, the man came to me, he had it, he came to me, said, this man is a prominent member of your church. Please, can you assist me to talk to him that he should offer, give me this contract? So eventually, I never knew the laws that guys had the awarding of contracts then. Then I spoke with the Baba. Eventually, the Baba gave the contract. On my own certificate, he gave that man the contract, and others who were bidding for it, they were asked to go. So within 3-4 weeks, he finished the work. Eventually, that Baba came to Abeokuta. In fact, he came to the vicarage to thank me that this man did a very wonderful job, and he appreciated it. I said, well, Baba, no problem. Eventually, Baba was going, whenever he comes, he will always give something. So eventually, he gave me money, and he went away. About 2 weeks after, one afternoon, this man just came. He said, my vicar, thank you very much. In fact, you met my need, this and that. And you know, there is a law guiding contract that when you ask somebody to get a contract in the government something, there is a percentage that they should give you.
Where is that law written?
I don't know. I said, what? No, you are my member before. I've left your church. But because you are good to me, and let me appreciate you, because even you did this job very well. Because Baba had come to appreciate me that I recommended you, and he said if he has another contract again, he will still call on you. So no problem. He said, please, I want to give you something. Though it's very small, please manage it. I said, well, I don't need anything, because actually you have done very well. I said, no, you have to take it. I said, I'm not taking anything. Because initially at the back of my mind, I thought it was a bribe.
So please ask your question, sir.
Now this is where I'm going. Eventually I went back to the wife, brought the wife, and they started with, eventually I got the check from, it was even a check. I thought it was a cash. So after they had left, I opened the check. It was 200,000. 200. I said, I not called him. What do you want me to do with this? You don't have a lot of this, but this is too much. He said, well, please, I should give you more because of what you have done.
So what's the question,
sir? My problem is this. Eventually, I collected the money.
You are still telling your story.
Yes. I paid the tithe. Eventually, I kept the rest. But when we got here, while we were discussing this issue,
your conscience began.
Yes, I was. Have I done something right? This is it.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, sir. Praise the Lord. You want to add to that question? I'm coming, sir. Now, this will be the last on this issue so that we can do our summary. Add to the question.
Thank you, sir. I'm not really adding. It's a clarification too.
Because I once heard Baba Adeboye said that when the Lord uses you for people, when miracle happen in the life of people, and they want to come and appreciate, that at times when he said no, God will tell him that you want to deprive the people of their blessing.
All right, I have heard. Yes. The first thing I want to do is let us remove personality. I hope you know that Pastor Adeboye is my father. So let's first of all remove who said what and who didn't say something. And let's look at the Bible. Because when you get to heaven, if you say, is Pastor Adeboye who said, Pastor Adeboye will say, excuse me, did I die for you? Am I the one who wrote the Bible in your hand? So that's the first thing we have to do. Now, so after having said that, let me come to first of all deal with it. Now, you see, the church member, in all sincerity, is probably properly motivated. Are you with me? He came to ask you for a favor. You did it. And he felt like appreciating. There's nothing too wrong from his side. I hope you are following what I'm saying. But then now the issue I am raising is this. As he brought the money to you, do you know that at that point he's feeling too indebted? Anything you tell him to do, he will do. So what we are saying now is that I don't want you to look at whether it's a sin or it's not a sin. That's not what I want you to see. What I'm trying to say is that if at that point that he's so indebted, he feels that under God, you have done something, I must do something back. If you, let's assume that you knew that there was a problem between him and his wife, which as a church member you have tried to solve and there's nothing, and he said, you see, it's all right. God is the one that has done this for you. Now, I want you to go and do this for God. Will he say no? So what we are saying is that indebtedness is an opportunity for God to eat first before the man of God will eat. I hope you are following what I'm saying. The issue is that at that point, the men that we have ministered to, they are willing to remove their eyes. I always say to ministers, because the people of God cannot find God physically, anything they feel like doing to God, who will they do it to? It's the man of God. And you know, when a man is indebted, he attempts to pay back for it with his pocket. That's the natural thing that a male human being will do. Women are not necessarily always like that. When a woman is touched, the next thing she opens is her bosom. When a woman is feeling very happy with somebody, they forget that you are a man of God. They want to grab you and embrace you. The reason is because once you touch the heart of a man, you touch his pocket. When you touch the heart of a woman, you touch her bosom. And that's the reason why many men of God fall into the sin of fornication. Because the woman wanting to show appreciation opens herself. And at that time, she's not thinking of the fact that I'm dealing with a man. He forgets that you are a man of God. He thinks he's God. He forgets that there is man off behind the God. And that the man is still what? He's a man. And then, when you do something and the community is indebted to you, they respond by praising you. So you see the three things that normally makes men of God to fall: money, women, and pride. That's how it comes. The man responds with his pocket. The woman responds with her bosom. The community, they respond with praise. So if the man of God does not know how to collect each one of these things for God first, and says, no, you don't give me on account of what God did. It's God who did this in your life. Go and do what? Take it back to God. Praise the Lord. Now, the issue of people will be blessed when they come to give you money. Yes, the Bible says give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. Yes. Those who are in the altar, when you give to them, when they bless you, the favor of God, what it does is that it opens the general favor of God towards them. That's the scriptures. But the blessing that comes from doing something for a man of God is not all in money. Are you with me? And it is not only money that the people will receive back when they do well to their mother. So, the first, to their man of God. So, the first thing I want you to remove your mind from is that blessing is not first and foremost money. Are you following what I'm saying? So, and a good man of God who is ministering to his congregation should be blessing his people regularly, isn't it? And he should be helping to open the heavens. Now, he should not first of all be at the instance of bringing an offering, or else it has a way of going to the eyes. I don't know whether you understand me. Praise the Lord. People will be blessed when they give as God leads them. It's not necessarily because we brought money, then something must come as a result. When you read, when you interpret the scripture like that, it almost makes it become something of a kalokalo. So you can calculate to go and give to God, so that you can do what? You can get back. That's not the spirit of scripture. Can we say that? See, it's better to teach your church members to be responsible to God in giving, rather than trying to give to God in order to provoke a blessing. That spirit is already antichrist. Because the spirit of Christ is a selfless, sacrificial gift giving out of love. If you teach your church members not to wait until they need money and then they are now looking at their body, I need 1,000. So if I give 10 naira, 10 times 100 is 1,000. And then they will be disappointed many times. Am I correct? Because we are all here. Have you not tried it before? Is it the 1,000 you went to give to God, you receive 100,000 in return? Does it come like that? So let's stop. Let's go to the Bible. And the truth is that if you have somebody who is giving as normally as the nature of Christ, as you give, men will give back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. It does not mean that as you give, you know, we have narrowly interpreted some scripture where it said, the same measure you give, that it shall be given to you. So when I give 1,000, God will multiply that. It doesn't work that way. Romans chapter 11, the last verse, isn't it said, who can give something to God in order that he will repay him? If you find that verse, will you read it for me? Have you found it?
Nitori.
Yes.
Lati odore. Ati nipare. Ati fun.
Yes.
Ni ongbogbo.
Yes.
Eni ti o go wa fun. Lai lai ami.
No. Go back up. Maybe it's not the last verse. Which verse is that?
That's 36.
Verse 35. Read verse 35 in Yoruba.
Tabi. Tani oko fi fun.
Taleni toko fi fun.
Ti a o si san pada fun.
Ti a si san pada fun.
Ti a o si san pada fun.
Read it from King English. Sir.
Who has ever given to him?
That God should repay him. Who has ever given to God that God should repay him?
Is that not a question? Who has ever given to God that God becomes indebted now, that God should repay him? Why? Because it is from him and of him that we receive everything. If Baba
Reverend gives me 50,000 now. And then I say, ah, praise God, I've received 50,000. And then I come and I say, Baba, Reverend, I just say I want to thank you. And I gave you 15,000. Am I expecting him to give me 150,000 back? From where did I pick the 15 I gave him? From him. So this matter of giving to God so that you can collect back from God is not the spirit of Scripture. The truth is that God, being a generous giver, he continues to give to his children. But he has also commanded his children to be given in order to open the heart of God towards them. Let's not teach our church members to play games with God. They will be narrow, they will calculate, they will do many things with their head. But if you teach them to open to God, generally speaking, you will see God, by the grace of God, coming to sit on them. I've seen church members that God went and sat upon and said, you have a generator in your house, and the church does not have generator. What do you mean by that? They will be bringing the generator and be shaking. You are the one begging them to carry it away. They say, no, I can't sleep again. I can't sleep. I've seen that. And I know that that will happen to us in the name of Jesus. If you permit me, you want to read the scripture. And I will not comment on that scripture.
Asking that question. The question God is asking you and I in Job 41 verse 11.
I wanted to quote Job 41.
It says, who has a claim against me?
Yes.
That I must pay.
That I must replay.
Everything under heaven.
Yes.
Belongs to me.
Praise the Lord. Thank you very much. I hope we have tried with that issue. What I just want you to carry away, generally speaking, first about gifts, is that that's something to be very careful about. That's something that can collect ministry from your hand. It collected ministry from the hand of Balaam. Do you remember Balaam? He was a man of God who could fall into a trance with his eyes open. But when the rewards of divination began to color his judgment, do you remember how Balaam died? How did he die? He died. It was the children of Israel who slaughtered him in battle. That's a man who could open his eyes and see into heaven. So what we are saying is that to keep your eyes open, to keep your sense of judgment balanced, the man of God should be very careful how he receives gifts. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. All right. I think we have dealt with that. And our time is almost gone. But I must, in the next 10-15 minutes, try to summarize the study for us. The study has been on effective shepherding. Praise the Lord. As a support to the theme of our sitting together with God on the transformed minister leading to a transformed people, a transformed congregation, we thought it was best for us to make this study on how to be an effective shepherd. On how you can be effective in carrying out your call. Excuse me, sirs. See, those who are engineers, who are lawyers, who are doctors, let me even take the man. I have some mates that we graduated together from the university. And while I went into the ministry, they remained on the campus and they were lecturing. A few years ago, I just looked back and I discovered that almost all my mates who remained on the campus, they are all professors. They are heads of department, they are this, they are that. They are professors. They have become established. They have become accomplished. So I was asking myself, they gave themselves to academics since we graduated together. And I told everybody that I've given myself to the ministry of God's word.
If they are making steady progress, should I not? Are you with me? If they are becoming professors, and you know, when I say professor, I was not thinking first in terms of their title, because I know the academic field very well. I know that before you become a professor, you will have published papers, you will have done hard work, you will have supervised projects, you will have done research. If they gave themselves to those things for the past a few decades that we have left school together, and they have been recognized, so why should I be in the ministry and be lazy? Will it be correct for me to use the cloak of a ministry to say that I've been in the ministry for the past how many years now, and nobody can see the marks of a man of God in my life? If I cannot be professor in the world, I should be able to profess Christ properly, isn't it? So the first challenge I wanted to bring to us in this study is that, look, if you are not effective as a shepherd, it's a disservice not only to God, it's also a disservice to the years you are putting into the ministry. For a man of God to claim that he's a reverend, he's a shepherd, he consigned his life to take care of the sheep for God, and for you not to do it well, is not correct. You have actually cheated yourself. Not only have you cheated God, which we all know, but you have also cheated yourself. So I am saying that the matter of becoming an effective shepherd should become a pursuit for each one of us as a man of God. While I am not pursuing title, I'm not saying, by now I also should be a venerable. That would be the wrong application of what I'm talking about. I'm not saying that, yes, I also become an archbishop. Praise God. If preferment and election and all such things bring you to that point, it's all right. But by the time I am appearing before God in heaven, I should be able to give a good account of my ministry. Am I correct? I should be able to point to lives that I have shepherded. I should be able to say, by the grace of God, when I was at St. David's Anglican Church, these lives that you committed into my hands, I did what I should. When the Bible says in Colossians chapter 1, the last few verses, when he said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. He said, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man with all everything, so that we may present every man, how? Perfect. Are you listening to me, sirs? The purpose of every man of God in ministry should be that anybody that passed through my hands, by the grace of God, when we get to heaven, I should be able to present that man, how? Perfect. Should be able to say, by the grace of God, by preaching the word of God, by the sharpness of my utterance and everything that you gave me, and the care and effectiveness of a preacher, I help this person to move from this point to this point in your purpose for that life. Praise the Lord. Is that a correct way to think as a man of God? So that's the reason why we were dealing with the issue of effective shepherding. And if you look at the study that we went in the 2 days, we can divide the issues into two major categories, isn't it? The first category is the life of the shepherd. The first key to effective shepherding is being the correct shepherd. Are you with me? It's not first the principles of shepherding that is the matter. Are you with me? You know that we go to seminaries, we go to pastors' colleges, we go to pastors' seminars, and they can teach us even the principles of church growth. Am I correct? If you want your church to grow, these are the things you should be doing. These are you be doing like this, we are doing like that. That is not the first key to being the kind of shepherd that will help people to succeed in life. What is the first key? Is for you yourself to become the correct shepherd. It is what you are that is first, not what you do. You can be doing all the correct things, but if you are not the correct man, you will still not produce correct people. And so we are seeing from our studies that as far as the Bible is concerned, a blind man that is leading other blind men, what is going to happen to all of them? They will all fall into the same ditch. As we studied it, it was beginning to show to me that, see, if there is a problem of sin or iniquity in the life of the man of God, it will take very serious effort on the part of the church members for them not to be falling into the same ditch of the same sin that the man of God himself is inside. If a man of God has a problem with women, his eyes cannot see women, something will begin to happen. Just go and check that congregation. You start discovering that unconsciously, the problem of immorality, the problem of my husband is pursuing other girls outside, will just be rampant inside that place. The reason is because it's the blind that is leading the blind, and both of them will fall into what? Into the ditch. I'm realizing also, see, supposing somebody is following me behind, they say, you don't know, you cannot see the road, though. Put your hand on my shoulder. And me myself, unfortunately, I cannot see, and I am going like this. Don't worry, I'm opening my eyes. But you see, it's because I have eyes that I can open it. Supposing I don't have eyes, what's going to happen when I take the next step? Now I want to ask you, if I take the next step and I fall boulder, which ditch will the person holding on to me fall into? The same one. Are you with me? He will fall on me, self. Can I fall into the ditch here and the person holding to me go and fall into that other ditch? Why? Because he is tied to me. There is an invisible cord that ties you to your church members. When you run into the problem of fornication and adultery, you drag your church members into it. When Baba Reverend is playing with figures in the office because account must balance, let's stop worrying the politicians that they are stealing our money. Because they are blind followers of who? Blind reverence. Has it not occurred to us that all these people that go to office and they go and steal money, and they are bearing the Barnabas, they are bearing Mark, they are bearing all those wonderful names, is it not our church that they are attending? But then the reverend will stand up and say, yes, something, something. But Baba Reverend, let's find out. Are we not producing after our own kind? The scripture says, every fruit tree bears seed, how? After his own kind. That's in Genesis chapter 1. Every seed, every fruit
You cannot see a mango tree producing apple. We will only produce the kind of politicians that the reverend is. If the reverend is an angry man, he gets to the pulpit. Of course, anything that happens in the pulpit, people assume is the anointing. Abi? They say it's God. And sometimes, God gets annoyed. Abi? Holy anger. I don't know where we got all those things. When the Bible says, those who commit these kind of things, and one of the things they listed is anger and wrath. Say, those who commit these kind of sins, they will not have a part in the kingdom of God. Those who do it, even if they are reverends. So the first part of the study, which we studied in different ways, is to show that we are responsible for the kind of society that we have today. Every reverend is responsible for his church members. He said, no, those people have been committing sin before they transferred me there. All right. If you stay 6 months in that place and they are still committing sin, it becomes your responsibility. You may not have been the one that led them into that sin, the first thing, but if you stay there and by ministry you did not affect them, you become a part of their problem. It only means that there is also already a weakness in our lives. Praise the Lord. The last thing I am going to say on this before I move to the second side is the fact that as we study the Bible, did we see there that Jesus was asking a question? He said, how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck of sawdust from your eyes, and behold, a log, a timber. One translation says, a log of timber. One translation says, a board. Another one says, a beam. A will beam. Imagine somebody carrying a beam in his eyes. And they now say, excuse me, sir, let me help you remove the speck of sawdust. What will the church member say to him? He say, bro, baba, if you succeed in removing the log in your own eyes, then you will see. Can I say to us, I'm sure that we probably said it in the Bible studies, but let's grind it very well. A sin in the life of a church member, heaven regards it as an ordinary what? Speck. Tiny speck of sawdust that somebody with clear eyes can simply go there and do what? And remove it. But if that same sin in the life of the church member, once he jumps inside the life of a man that is wearing cassock and surplice, heaven no longer regards it as a speck. How does heaven see it? As a log. So if my church member is pursuing small girls, what does the angels in heaven record? There's a speck of sawdust in chief so-and-so, who is a member of the church of this reverend so-and-so. But if they check the life of the man of God, even if it is only that he is not really committing fornication, no, there is just a small girl in the choir that after they finish, normally he rubs her body, just touches her breast. He has never slept with the girl. When the angels are going to record it in heaven, what will they record? It's a log. I hope you are following what I'm saying. The Bible says, and I think this is Romans, maybe Romans chapter 2, I hope I'm correct. He said we should not be many masters, or else we will receive what? The greater condemnation.
James say, if you are teaching others, you that teach people not to steal, are you stealing? Then the issue of few stripes and much stripes, you can see it. Let's understand that sin in your own life is not at the same level with sin in the life of a church member. Anything that is wrong in your life, when I was growing up as a pastor, and I began to want to move close to God, and really I was crying, God, use me. God said, if I'm going to use you, then I will work on you first. I said, God, I don't mind. I'm ready. And God started working on me. If I want to do this, trouble. God will say, no, you cannot do that. When I do this, they say, no, check even your laughter. How are you laughing? So one day I said, God, this is too much now. If I do this, it's sin. Every time I go to Boko, I have to cry, and come back. How long will I be crying? I told God, I said, I'm even tired of repenting. Have you gotten to that point before? Say, I'm tired of repenting. I've been repenting all my life. You know what God said to me? He said, every man of God is a template. You know what they call template? You see, when I was young, there was a carpenter's workshop in our compound where I used to live in Lagos. And when I finish school, I will run into this carpenter's shed and I'm learning how to cut wood and all of that. There is this thing they call the template in his workshop. It's usually a plywood that the carpenter takes time to measure. For example, in those days, they used to make the arm of a chair. You know those kind of chairs that when you sit on it like this, I think this kind. Now they are covering them with upholstery. Aha, look at that chair. So they will take a plywood and measure the exact length, the exact width. They will round it. They will make sure it's accurate. Then they make a small hole in it and hang it in the workshop. When you come to him and say, make me a chair, he doesn't bother to be measuring hand of your own chair. He just brings the template. Are you following me? Put it on the wood and use pencil to mark it out. And he cuts it, and it is going to be exactly like that. That's a template. Something that you use to multiply several. Like God said, you see, as a man of God, you are what? You are a template. Any error in your life, what's going to happen? It's going to be multiplied over. Everybody will use your life to affect. Don't be tired of God correcting you if you want to be an effective man of God. Don't be tired of repenting. Don't be tired of adjusting your life. You will only prepare yourself to be an effective shepherd tomorrow if you adjust to everything that God brings your way. But if God is pointing at something in your life, the same thing God has been shouting, do this one, repent about this. He said, God, Abba, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Whatever makes you weak has already made your shepherding what? Weak. Because it is whatever happens in your life that is going to be multiplied over several lives. Praise the Lord. So we cannot overemphasize this aspect. The beginning of the journey to effectiveness in ministry does not begin with plenty knowledge about how to do ministry. It begins with working on your life to become the kind of life that God will not be afraid to multiply. Praise the Lord. Now, the second aspect of ministry, the second aspect of our study, which we now began to see the kind of way in which God wants us to do shepherding. Several of the scriptures that we read there, if I attempt to open any one of them, we'll be spending much more time. But I just want to bring a little summary. The shepherd is meant to feed the sheep.
isn't it? Say, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof. I see ministry work as a selfless work. It's a sacrificial work. Anybody who is looking for fast gain should not come near ministry. Anybody that it is the gains of what they will bring to you, that is the thing that is at the back of your mind, you really have no place in shepherding. Because there was a statement that they made there. Instead of feeding the sheep, if you start feeding on the sheep, is there a difference or not? Now, you see, that's the major matter. Some people are in the ministry to do what? To feed on the sheep. But those who feed on the sheep, hey, is it Ezekiel that God said, I am against you shepherds? Isn't it? Say, I'm against you. You scatter my flock. You allow my flock to become a prey. You are eating my flock anyhow. I'm against you. I will deal with you. The shortest cut to coming under divine condemnation is to become a pastor who has no love for the sheep, but who is only there for what he will gain. So the Bible says, feed the sheep. One scripture says, preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Teach. Preach with all long suffering. A pastor cannot be tired of teaching and repeating the same thing. Because you are supposed to give to each person their portion of meat. You are supposed to give to each life. If these first three rows, they are my congregation, and I have succeeded with Venerable Adedayo here, I have preached to him, and I've given his portion of meat, and it's growing very well, but there's somebody at the back there that I have not done. Have I finished my work? Even if it is the same thing I told the Venerable, that I need to tell him and say, but you were there when I was talking. How did Venerable catch it and you didn't catch it? That's not an excuse. If he has not caught his own, he has not caught his own. And it is hanging on my neck. The shepherd has to be dedicated. He has made up his mind that he will feed the sheep, he will walk on them until they become God's purpose for their life. We read several scriptures there, which I don't want to be tempted to start looking at. But as I am looking at this effective shepherding as a whole, I felt like God is saying, there is something I want to achieve in the lives of people. Will you join me in carrying it out? Who is a shepherd? Somebody who joins with the chief shepherd to bring to pass the will of the chief shepherd for each of the sheep. Once you accept the caller and you accept the pastorate, what you have said under God is, Lord, if these people don't become like God, like you want them to become, I agree to be partly responsible. Hold me responsible. So we cannot stand on the pulpit and say, well, ati so fun iwo mo eniyan. Eh? What God is demanding of you, whether you like, do it. If you don't like, it's your problem. That's not a shepherd. That's not a shepherd. He said, feed the flock, taking the oversight. What's the meaning of that? Supervising how they eat what you give them. So when you preach on Sunday and you have thrown bread everywhere, you have broadcast your bread, Once you come down from your pulpit, you need to go and check the stomach of your parishioners, whether the bread you threw did what? Landed in the correct place. That's shepherding. It's not just something that we stand and we say, well, my own job is to preach 3 times a week, and I preached. I have written the report and sent it to the diocese. Well, nobody can blame me. I've done my job. Even if the bishop does not blame you, the chief shepherd is looking. Lives have been committed into our hands, and these lives, by the grace of God, there is a purpose that the Father in heaven has for their life. Will you pray with me this afternoon that I will not be guilty of coming into the pastorate? I am not going to be, I will not go to hell simply because I became a reverend. I will not be guilty of what I'm supposed to do. Lord, please help my life. Will I ask us to stand on our feet as we take some few minutes to pray? Please talk to God tonight and say, Lord, please help me. First and foremost, let me be the kind of person that you will willingly multiply in my church. If everybody in your church is like you, how will that church be? And yet, everybody is going to become like you eventually. Can you pray and say, God, make me the right kind of person that you can freely multiply in your church? Make me the right kind of shepherd that you can freely release your sheep to. Do something to me so that I will be able to help others. Please pray.